see me or someone like me about 1 week ago in this position, but this will be the last time. I'm here to make announcements, but my only announcement is that Mary Edes, we are very fortunate to have her here as our preacher and worship leader today. Mary, thank you for coming and coming back to be with us. Are there any other announcements I should share with everyone?
There's the Interfaith Pride Service this afternoon at 4 o'clock in Nativity Lutheran. And I think, who all is going to be there, but the clergy from various congregations throughout the valley, and some lay speakers as well, and the Silver Lake Singers will be singing. And it's sort of a blessing for the beginning of Pride Week, and we're all warmly invited to attend that.
We are one of the sponsors. It's an interfaith sponsorship from churches all across the Mount Washington Valley, and interfaith different roles along the way. It should be very interesting to attend, as many and all of the services you find worthwhile. Meg.
On that note, I'm looking at the bulletin about the Friday afternoon at 2 o'clock. I think it will be here at the church. In response to all the questioning and so forth about the library hour, which is that Gail Doctor is leading a discussion about that. It's kind of a question and answer discussion period to open up the forum to more adults, because I guess the story hours for children and with parents or with adults. And so she's decided that in order to facilitate more discussion in the valley, that she would have a session here. So it's in your bulletin, but it's 2 o'clock Friday afternoon. We'll be here in the Jackson Church.
Reminds me of the ask a question to a Muslim.
Exactly.
We had about a year ago. Opportunity to share knowledge, wisdom, and insight. Any other thing I'll ask you, Mary, to lead us to worship?
Well, it says right here, passing of peace. So I think we should do that.
Thank you.
those who don't know me, I am Mary Edes, and I have been here a number of times over the years, and always, always look forward to making the trip north, far north, from Silver Lake, New Hampshire. I'm really glad I'm not going south. Already bumper to bumper to bumper. Welcome summer. Please stick around afterwards for coffee, tea, juice, water, conversation. I'm assuming there's some food out there too, so we can get blood sugar levels up after I switch into Bill's mode. Well, I'm so glad you're here. Let's see, our opening hymn is number 6. Bring many names, all 1,000 persons. All right. Feel so moved, feel free to speak the name or your concern into the silence.
For all those who are dealing with life-changing illnesses and those who are caring for them, may we have the strength to see this.
Bikers were killed on the road this week. And for the driver of the truck. And for all the ripples that will flow out from that for years to come.
Baby Bennett, who at 6 months left Children's Hospital, and his cousin Emma, 2 months, who is still in Children's Hospital.
Let's pray. Holy One, we give thanks for the opportunity to be together this morning. Knowing that our prayers for all those mentioned here have been heard. May their names and our best hopes rise up to meet them, even as we meet this new day. I do give thanks. I do indeed. As I realize more and more my connection to all that is, as my faith in the profound and mysterious fact that you and I are one increases. I begin to recognize my reflection in the mirror of the world. I observe the leaping green spirits of trees and know that our coming to life, our ever-growing and our passage into eternity, has its origin in the same unfolding, never-ending process. First full-blown summer Sunday. We are of the earth. We change together as one, adapting to ancient cycles. We can influence them, but we cannot stop them. We can mask them from ourselves, but they are beyond our control. And so in this new season, turn as you are pulled to turn, knowing that we move with the same inner rhythm, guided by the Spirit, sustained in community and in love. We are awake and alive just now. Just now. The precise and elegant pattern that you are will never be repeated. And the physical memory of your presence will be a part of all that remains beyond your time. For all time. Be comforted in. Extend love wherever you go. Let kindness and compassion rule your heart and all your relations. By this, may we all be blessed and live well. We now join you, if you will, in the prayer of our heritage, saying, Our Father, scripture reading this morning is from Exodus 3, chapters 9 to 14. Verses 9 to 14. We weren't going to read all those chapters, sorry. Priest of Midian, he led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Oreb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. And then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to him, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses! And he said, Here I am. And then he said, Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land.
milk and honey to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to the Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be a sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. The divine name revealed. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what's his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. I don't know about that. That's why I'm here. So before the second reading, a little story. When my daughter Eliza was in the third grade, the students in her class went on to a field trip out into the woods. It was close to the elementary school in Newmarket, and they went out with their classroom teacher and their guidance counselor. So the guidance counselor asked the children to look around the forest and pick out the tree that each one of them thought looked the most like themselves, and then come back and meet the group and tell them why. Why is that tree most like you? Well, Eliza looked and looked. Looked. I think she was the last child to finish the assignment. Finally, she came sort of sheepishly up to her teacher because she was afraid to tell the guidance counselor that she was pretty sure she had done the assignment wrong. She held out a tiny acorn in her hand and said to her teacher, I couldn't find a tree that's like me. I think this is what's most like me, because I'm not done growing. And I don't know what I'm going to be. And that child shall leave them. Even at that young age, Eliza got it, that creation, that naming is important. Not to be rushed. Naming is a process. Being human is a process. History, our story, is still opening within us and around us every day. Holy, holy, so that same child, Eliza, came rushing home from school one day when she was in high school. Said, Mom, found this great poem today, and you've got to preach about it someday. Thus our second reading. Fall by Russell Edson. There was a man who found two leaves and came inside, holding them out, saying to his parents that he was a tree, to which they said, then go out into the yard and do not go into the living room as your roots may ruin the carpet. He said, I was fooling. I'm not a tree. And dropped his leaves. But his parents said, oh, look, it is fall. Wow.
not that light fall this morning. It is the first Sunday in honest to God summer. Can you even believe it? Oh, amen. Can we get amen? It's finally summer. We didn't have spring, but it is summer. Far from falling, the leaves in our neck of the woods are now greening. They were tiny on the tips of branches just a few weeks ago, waiting for the right amount of sun and rain and God's good time. And now, overnight it seems, the temperature is soaring. And they hang, ready to provide us with some welcome shade. Someone, I can't remember who or where, said that in New England we have two foliage seasons. Fall, of course, when the leaves are ablaze in red and orange and yellow and gold. How like the flaming bush disclosing to Moses God's presence. But we also have spring, when every conceivable shade of green bursts forth over according to our color-thirsty eyes after winter's long, frosty palette fades. Bless the leaves in every season, I tell you what. So as I reread Russell Edson's poem, which is one of my favorites, I began to think of all the different leaves I have held out and later dropped in my own life as I move ever closer to the core, to the heart of who I am called to be in this lifetime. Today I will speak about naming, about the different leaves we hold out to the world in proclamation, about the dreams and expectations that grow out of the names we give to ourselves and the names we are given by others, about the shape that our naming gives to our lives and to the world. Here in the Jackson Community Church, you take seriously the ongoing task of living into the name Community Church, asking, who are we? Really? What leaves do we hold in common? What beliefs? What core values? What do we hope for? What do we dare dream? This is some of the most important naming you will ever do as a religious body, for it is by this naming process that you hope to affect change in yourselves, in your town, in the valley, in the world. What leaves will you hold out and say, this is who we are? As daunting as it is to do this, you are attempting to draw some of the leaves you've held for generations, opening yourself to the possibility of new growth. And so even as liberal new leaves begin opening all around us, let's ponder together the power of this naming. It is written, in the beginning was the Word became flesh. I do believe there's a great deal of truth to the idea of the Word and its power. Creation springs forth from the Word in every moment of every day. We do, in very real ways, create the world in which we live by the words we use to name that world. So naming and creation go hand in hand. We name our children, our pets, we name our businesses, our schools, our churches, and we try to choose names that we feel will say something about the bearer, the wearer of that name. The names we choose or are given are invested with hopes and dreams and expectations. Naming is an imaginative, a brave, and creative act. In every culture and time, we name and are named from womb to tomb. And until we are old enough to form the word for ourselves, We are named solely by others. And thus begins the Creator's story of our life on Earth. Most of us get a formal name when we are born, but not always. My mother tells me that my great-grandmother, being the last child in a very large family, was simply called Sister until she was old enough to choose her own name, at which time she named herself Sarah Henrietta. I wonder what names any of us might have chosen for ourselves, given that chance, given that charge and opportunity. We are given other kinds of names from very early in our lives as well. One of the first expectation-laden names we receive is that of gender. Just think how much expectation grows out of the naming of a child. In these days, long before the child is born, the naming of a child, he or she. Our parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, indeed our culture, has a vast array of dreams and expectations for our sons and daughters. And many of those dreams are based in large part on the gender of the person for whom we dream of. Today, we're beginning to recognize the fluidity of gender. We're coming to understand that the gradations of gender identity along the colorful spectrum are slimmer and more nuanced than most of us ever imagined, even a generation ago. Beyond gender and given name, our earliest names are simple. Names like Sweet, 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 Sweet. And a name where I hail from, Cullen, and she Cullen. Cranky, colicky, easy baby, active. Pretty or handsome, just like her mom, or just like his dad. Already our life begins to take shape from these early names. I would venture to say that I am not the only woman who thought she had a pretty good handle on her child's personality type from before the time he or she was born. Simply from the way my daughter Eliza felt when I carried her in my body, I expected her to be feisty and fiery and fun. And I spoke of her in those terms long before she was born. She is all of those things and more. But I wonder, how much did my expectations form her way of being in the world? Think of all the other ways we name ourselves today. We name ourselves by occupation, by age, by gender, by sexual orientation, by race, nationality, marital status, religious affiliation, academic degree, personality type. What am I? ENFJ. ENFJ. Personality type, zodiac sign, and more. Many names come with props, visual aids. Leaves for us to hold out to the world to see as we proclaim, look, I'm a tree. And yet none of our names by themselves can capture the unique essence of any and every creature. Just as there is no single name large enough, broad enough, expansive enough to capture the mystery we call God, so is there no name that will sufficiently capture the essence of the human spirit, not mine, not yours. It's been my observation that we are more apt than not to name ourselves and each other based on our occupations, present or former. Go to any party or other such gathering and listen to folks introduce one another. If their job is not mentioned in the actual introduction, the question arises almost immediately in the subsequent conversation. So
So what do you do?
What do you do? And like or not, the answer you give carries with it a preconceived notion of who you really are. I don't know if this is still true, but I well remember my early days of child rearing when I had chosen to stay home with my children. Hearing the conversation come to a near standstill when I said that I did not work outside the home. All of a sudden, it was as if my IQ had dropped precipitously, or I had developed a visible rash. It was potentially contagious. I'm exaggerating, of course, but it was always an awkward moment. It was like, oh, I stay home with my kids. Oh, nice. How about that? Actually, met a woman on Star Island last week who was about the age I was at that point. She's in her early 30s. And I fell right into it. So what do you do? She said, I'll stay at home, Mom. And then she waited. And I said, great. Good for you. And she said, usually people think I'm stupid if I say that. So it hasn't changed. And this is 40 years later. Likewise, how often have I stood among a group of women friends discussing family life or cares of the day, and one of them said something like, well, my husband's an engineer. And we all groan and roll our eyes in knowing and pitying ways. Or she could have named him lawyer, doctor, or God forbid, musician, or actor. Minister, Scorpio, Libra, Pisces, every name carries with it expected baggage. Feminist, atheist, humanist, Christian, Muslim, liberal, conservative. She's a lawyer. He's a nurse. We all do it. We do it to ourselves, and we do it to others, and we do it without even thinking about it. When I was first in seminary, I took a course where we were asked to write a personal ad in which, in 25 words or less, we named ourselves for some unknown reader. It was not easy, and I would challenge you to try it sometimes. Two of the young men in the class, earnest and good and true and committed to the church, told how they had each waffled and recanted when they thought to use the name Christian to describe themselves in print. It made me angry and sad to think that the name had become for them so loaded with competing and preconceived notions of what that means, that these men, who were indeed Christians of the truest and best kind, felt they could not name themselves as such for fear of misunderstanding, rejection, or even ridicule. I only vaguely remember what I wrote myself in that course, and I wonder what I would write today. What would you write? Describe yourself. If you were to pick just five words with which to name yourself today, just five words, what would they be? What are the names you might think to take only to quickly drop your leaves and say, no, I was fooling. I'm not a tree. Five words, how would you name this congregation, your church? What five words would you choose, and in what order? What does it mean to name who we are religiously as individuals, as a faith community? Here in this congregation, I assume you may call yourself by various names, religiously speaking. It's a community church. What does it mean to call yourself a Protestant, a Christian? A member of the United Church of Christ, a Methodist, a Unitarian Universalist, an agnostic, conservative, liberal.
include it in your personal ed? There's some names we would choose for ourselves, some that we must choose if we are to be true to who we are and to what sense and what we sense is our purpose on this planet. These are the names that give our life shape and meaning, and having pronounced these names aloud, we may be seen differently because of that name. More important still, we may suddenly see ourselves more clearly. The names we choose as religious persons are like that, and so we choose with great care, I dare say with reverence. As I've shared here before, one of the names I wear with profound gratitude is that of birthright universalist. I have what I consider the vast good fortune to be able to count myself among the last generation of souls born into the pre-merger Universalist Church tradition. It is a name that has shaped my way of being in the world from the day I was born. John Perrins, a former Unitarian Universalist Association president, spoke of the Universalist half of our name this way, quote, "Early Universalists knew that the mission of the Church is twofold, to preach a prophetic gospel and to provide a community of acceptance, especially to those who feel unacceptable, even to themselves. They also knew that if hospitality is the basic religious virtue, there is an obligation to share it." End quote. I'm still deeply committed to universalism, that is to say, to the widest possible welcome. Even as I seek to articulate what that might look like in this present generation and for the benefit of those who carry on long after I'm gone. But again, universalist is only one of the names that I choose to give shape to my life. The process of naming is as old as human history, and it has always been really more art than science. Somehow we must learn to work with names as though they were more like clay than stone. As I wrote that last line, I thought again of the idea of the word becoming flesh. Flesh. Soft and pliable, easily bruised, hopefully healed, changing. As we live and grow, think how your flesh has changed in 5 years, 10 years, 50 years, and more. We must feel for ourselves and grant to others the grace and permission to change and grow and change again. One of my favorite Bible passages is the one we read this morning, where Moses asked God what God's name is. The story says that Moses went up to the top of that mountain, and while he was there, he heard God's voice speaking to him and telling him what he, Moses, needed to do for his people. But again, Moses said to God, "What will I say to the people when they ask me who told me these things? What will I tell them? What's your name, for God's sake?" And God said to Moses, probably rolling his eyes, I'm guessing his, her, there, "Eyeh Asher Eyeh. Eyeh Asher Eyeh. I am who I am. Or I am what I am. Or my favorite translation, I will be what I will be." God refuses to be put in a convenient box for easy storage and recognition. If we believe in a created universe, a created and creating God, if we believe ourselves to be made in that image, in the image of I will be what I will be, if we, like God, are always being and becoming. In Russell Edson's poem, Fall, The man picks up two leaves and names himself a tree. This new name elicits from his parents a swift response. You cannot be that thing and remain a part of our lives. And so he says, I was fooling. I'm not a tree. And drops his leaves. But his parents say, look, it is fall. The word had already created a new reality in the minds of his parents, who from then on saw him only through the filter of that name. My husband Stephen and I each have children who are grown, most of the children of their own. Over the next several years, they and their youngsters will come to us and hold out their leaves for us to see. I pray for the wisdom and courage it will take to listen and to love and to respect their growing, their journeying, their self-naming. I sometimes think that we spend our entire lives listening for our one true name. Long to be known by a name far deeper than our title or our job, than our gender or our income. Listening for that which we are called to be in this world, to do and to be in this world. Like the prophet Jeremiah, we long to hear our name spoken by the great I Am. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. So we do. We hear our true name, sometimes only quietly, or only for a moment. We may hear it in the voices of our partners, our dear friends, our children. We hear it sometimes in the salty breeze as we stride along the seashore, or the rhythm of waves, and the rustling of the leaves along the river, the sound of our own breathing, and the beating of our own heart as we work in the garden or sit quietly with a friend. I like to believe that that name is in our heart when we are born, and on the lips of the mysterious beyond when we pass from this world, in every moment taking shape within us. Here in this place, you join together in this process of being and becoming. For generations, you sat side by side, singing and praying, seekers of understanding, of meaning. Some of us were raised and renamed Congregationalists, or you members of the United Church of Christ, some Universalists and or Unitarians, some Methodists, I presume some previously unchurched, some from Roman Catholic upbringing. Together, we are the teachers and preachers, techies and artists, businessmen and women, laborers, retired from paid labor. We are all these names and more beside, like a crazy quilt. We are loosely held together by good and simple thread. The question remains, will it hold? Can your many theological hues shine forth against a rich and vibrant backing, the color of love? Only time will tell. In the years to come, I hope and pray that the Jackson Community Church will continue to be a place where people can come to listen for and proclaim their true selves, their true names in the presence of other seekers, believers and non-believers, trusting that you can learn from one another, remembering that you do not need to believe alike, to love alike. holding out your tender leaves, tentatively or bravely, with faith enough in one another to not send any away or to be told yourselves to go outside so your roots will not ruin this carpet. As we fling open the windows for the first time in months and let the breezes blow through these familiar and beloved rooms, may you be filled with sweet-smelling breath of daily new beginnings. Recognizing finally, as Moses did, that your feet are planted on holy ground. This congregation is standing courageously, leaves held out in a spirit of welcome, and the dear hope that your naming will be broad enough to hold each and every one of us and anyone else that comes through that door. I encourage you to claim your leaves, your religious identity, your name. Hold fast. Let your roots grow deep into the soil of this place, gathering nourishment and strength for the days and years to come. The work of the world lies before us. Let us name that task as our own. Blessed be. Sing together, number 409, How Can We Name a Love?
Thank you.
I have to pick up a little service because I think I screwed it up somewhere along the way. Let's see. This is where I turn to you for help. And this is open. Let us now take up an offering for the good work of this church.
Thank you.
first. Benediction first. May the God of all creatures, great and small, bless you and keep you until we meet again. Go in duty to love and serve the world.
Shall we sit for the post-food? Do you want to listen?